Welcome to the 33 show. This is episode 2, and my guest today is Mark Sargent from Flat Earth Clues and Enclosed World. How are you, Mark?
I am well. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you for being here, man. I'm really excited to get going. We tried this a few minutes ago and there was no audio. That was my fault. So if you guys were in the chat, I'm sorry. Thanks for telling us. So we just decided to do the easy way, just go with Google Hangouts. So So Mark, what we're going to discuss today, I thought we'd discuss simulation theory and flat earth and see how they combine. But before we get there, I want to talk about video games, because I know you love video games. You come from a video gaming background. So I thought we'd start on that and see where we go from there. Is that all right with you?
Yeah, that's so, absolutely fine.
Same. I love video games. I've been playing them since I was a kid. And seeing the progression to where we are now, it's amazing. Like, I've recently got myself one of those virtual reality headsets from Sony.
Yeah.
And unbelievable, Mark. Like, you literally cannot tell the difference after a while. Your brain just sort of gets disorientated and it's hard to tell. So I want to get your points and your views on what you think progression's been like since, the 90s, maybe up until now in a...
The video game industry has really evolved over the years, and of course we'll get into what they're aspiring to be, which they're kind of tickling right now. But back in the day, because I'm older than you, and I was back when games were in their utter infancy, you know, the Atari 2600 with horrible block graphics, but that was the best. You know, we still loved what it was, and my first console was a ColecoVision. My friend had an Intellivision. Other people's had Sega Genesis, and there was all the stand-up games. I was a huge fan of all the old school arcades where you pumped quarters into things, and a little known story, which I love, where when Apple was first starting out, there was another guy, the founder of Atari, Nolan Bushnell. And he was, you know, really, you know, they wanted to join forces at some point, and Nolan's like, nah, you know, I'm going to do this whole home console game thing. And when he made a whole bunch of his money, you know, he sold out and made hundreds of millions of dollars. He was the guy that founded, at least in the States, Chuck E. Cheese Pizza Time Theater, which was a huge chain of arcades. I got into the game. So I was playing hardcore as a kid. And then I got into the gaming industry just by, through a weird cool back door. I won a gaming tournament in the mid 90s. It was a computer pinball tournament when pinball simulations started getting better and better. And there was a little company out of Tokyo, Japan called Little Wing. And they made a game called Crystal Caliber and Pinball. And it was the first, simulated computer pinball thing with a tournament. It was really, really good. And I was playing it, and I don't mind saying this because it's been years since I won that tournament, but I did tend to bend the rules a bit when it comes to things. And I found a way, because when you're playing the tournament, it creates an encryption code. So you send your score, the encryption code, they match up the code with the score to make sure it's completely legitimate. And I was going, well, geez, how are they generating this damn thing? And I figured out that they were generating it from the score plus an algorithm that was tied to the date timestamp of the computer. I was going, okay. But they assumed that the date timestamp is always legit, because it is. It's always legit. So I was going, okay, so what if I do my score, and then just before I generate the algorithm, let me change the date 1 month forward, right? And I set that score in, and it worked. I was going, okay, I know exactly. Because I was playing a lot of games that were really – I was wasting games that were really, really good, because you can only turn in one score per month. And so, like, if you get 1 billion points, 900 million, even though it took you a couple hours, didn't do anything. Anyway, the point was I finished the tournament. I played the tournament out 6 months before it even ended and didn't tell anybody. I just, you know, waited and sent in my highest scores as, you know, I could play casually, because I didn't – it was a year-long tournament. The point was I won it, and I didn't turn it into a horse race. And because of that, the company called me up and said, hey, you know, how would you like to test one of our new products? And I tested it. And I wrote a scathing review. I said, oh, this thing's got so many problems with it. You really need to tighten it up. And the developer out of Japan said, hey, you might want to hire this guy. So they hired me. I went out to Boulder, Colorado, which is a really weird place, because most of your gaming stuff is in California in the United States, some in New York, some in San Francisco, but most of it's in California. But I was in Boulder, Colorado, never been there. And I started up, and this was in the golden age of PC gaming. Oh my God. You know, I'll rattle off some stuff to you. You know, if you'll know some, maybe you won't know others, but like, the guys from id when they were making Doom and Quake, the guys from Bungie before they made Halo, they made a little game for the Macintosh called Marathon. And then all the other there weren't that many people out there making the stuff. It was, you go to the conventions and it was a really intimate crowd and everybody knew everybody. And, I saw, I was playing stuff like, I still play World of Warcraft now, but before World of Warcraft, there was Warcraft 3, Warcraft 2, then Warcraft 1, Orcs and Humans. And I started seeing the limits of gaming. This where we're kind of rolling into what we're talking about. Came down to graphics processing. So how good could you, there was bottlenecks everywhere, you know? Yeah, the internet was super, you know, you had to deal with modem speeds, but that got up to be pretty quick. And then you had dedicated video cards, and those video cards got better and better. And so games were pushing the envelope always. It's like, okay, how much resolution can we crank into this? And then the television started getting into it most recently. I mean, there's 4K televisions, but a lot of the games aren't 4K games yet. And they all are aspiring to be, you know, everyone, we all know where it's going. And that is the virtual reality games where you put on a headset or they plug something in. You know, we've seen it in science fiction movies where you lose track of where you are. And I've seen the commercials recently for some of these headsets that are coming out. And you also got to remember that we are designed to be, I firmly believe, as human beings, I think we are designed to fall for these illusions. There's a term out there, some people know it, some people don't, called suspension of disbelief, which is, you go, what's that? Well, when it doesn't have to do with just movies, but we'll use movies and television. Why do you cry or get emotional in a movie theater? Like, look, you know you're in a movie theater, you're sitting next to other people, you paid your money to get in there, these actors that are on the screen, you've seen them in other movies. In fact, you know the plot, you read the book for the movie, right? And yet you still get emotional. And that is because your mind temporarily throws all that out the window and it wants to be immersed in what that is. And the video game industry is trying to capitalize on that. Of course, you know, the adult entertainment will probably jump on it even faster because that's what always happens. But the video game entertainment industry, they want this more than anybody, because once you do that, once you suck somebody in, I mean, there's people that are serious video game addicts already, you know, just what we have. Once that happens, once that headset, you know, that you've got gets refined just a couple more notches, then you're talking about blurring the lines. And we'll talk about movies that touch on this. But we're talking about blurring the lines between where we are. And I've got a firm, where we're going to be. I there's so many different ways I could go here, but I don't want to completely monopolize it. So that's how I started. And that's where I'm going. So yeah, we've really come a long ways we're really close to what all technology is aspiring to be, which is creating a virtual world.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, the progression, also the way it worked was, do you remember there were cafes where you used to go and play games, like in a network setup where you used to have loads of computers in a massive room and you used to pay and play together? Do you remember those?
Oh yeah. LAN games. Local area network games. Things. Yeah.
So yeah, single-player games to multiplayer games in a room, and now we're multiplayer games worldwide, and then it sort of just starts to blur, doesn't it? And then once you get the virtual reality on, and that's it.
Yeah, the
it becomes like real life.
When the games changed, I remember vividly playing LAN network games, you know, when it was Doom and Quake and Warcraft 2. And that was when you were only the maximum you could like get 8 players in a game, maybe. And then there was started to do some online stuff where you could play, you were playing, you know, you still were limited to the amount of players, but then you were playing, you didn't have to be in the same room. And then when the MMORPGs came out, the massive multiplayer games, like I remember the huge battle that was, this epic battle that was going to happen between when World of Warcraft first came out and Sony's EverQuest 2. That was supposed to be it. And the marketers didn't realize when it came out. And this is how, when things really, really changed. Because the game is real time and it never shuts down, doesn't matter if you're playing or not, that game is still progressing. There are people in the game always, you know, and since there's people all over the world and, you know, there's time zones, there's people that are, when you're asleep, they're playing. They didn't realize that it's a winner take all scenario, meaning you can only play, you only have so many hours in the day. So all of a sudden, and once people say, hey, this Warcraft thing is kind of cool, the EverQuest servers just emptied out and everybody went over there because you can't be in two nightclubs at the same time. You can only be in one. And that's when that's when things really, really changed. And then people were dedicating a lot of money, you know, monthly subscriptions. Mm. That's when you're talking real money, where Blizzard was making upwards of $150 million a month, you know, in just subscription service. It's not like they were, you know, the people were even buying new packaging or anything like that. And then when you got rid of packaging altogether to where the latest games you just download, it's gotten to where it's now, it's dedicated. It can monopolize all your time. And so now everyone wants it to take it to that last step, which is total immersion, to where then you start getting into the scary little aspects, like you lose time. In fact, there was what was that movie with Bruce Willis? Somebody in chat will probably be able to tell us real quick, that where people were logged into, you know, avatars, you know, robot avatars bodies. I'm not saying that ever happened, because they're never going to solve that power source. But once you get into like, what was the big one that's out there that people play? It's running all the time. Second Life.
Second Life.
Yeah. Second Life. If there was an immersive Second Life system out there, that's when, you know, you got people that, I hate to say that it would really, that it potentially would damage society, but it has a chance of doing that, because then you've got people, their entire goal is just to make enough money to pay to jack in. That's it. Mm-hmm. So your apartment would be crap. You know, it's like, you don't even need, you know, two 3,000 square foot house. Why? You need one room with a comfy chair and something to put your headset in and a decent, you know, uninterrupted power supply.
Yeah.
And that's all you need. And people, that's all they do all day long, if it was good enough. And that's what we're angling to get.
So that takes us onto the next point that I was thinking about, this whole simulation theory. Do you think it's a coincidence that we are hearing about all of these scientists coming out and saying that we could be in a simulation, and Elon Musk? And I mean, I don't believe anything that comes out of these people, to be honest. And at this point, whatever they say, I just look at it as just words. I just, you know, it's because they lie so much. And you know, of course, being a flat earther, how much lies surround us. So whenever these things come out, I'm always cautious. I'm always thinking, why are they saying it? And then I see this whole virtual reality thing picking up. So do you think it's a coincidence that they're talking about it, or do you think there's something more to it? Is there an agenda? Is it real? What's your view?
Oh yeah. It's definitely an agenda, and it's a contradiction on top of it, which is weird, because, you know, Elon Musk, he keeps talking. On one hand, he's got rockets that are blowing up on the pad and blowing up, you know, as soon as they lift off. But then he delivers this big speech about how he's going to colonize Mars, and his stock prices go up. And I'm still staring at that going, how in the world are you getting away with that? You just blew up a rocket on the pad, and you're talking about and people are cheering, and the mainstream media is going, how Elon Musk is going to colonize Mars? I'm going, no, you're not colonizing anything, man. Mm. But so why would he even talk about colonizing Mars? And then just before that, talk about how the world, you know, the universe could be a simulation. And Neil deGrasse Tyson, same sort of thing. He was the only physicist in that panel, and I can't remember the name of the panel that he was doing it on, where he was saying that, oh yeah, simulation theory, very, very possible. It's like, you know, like almost inevitable. I'm going, okay, no, I don't think it's a coincidence, because as you know, you're in as about as deep as anybody. Mm. The detection ability of the internet is honed right now to razor sharpness. We pretty much, if anything's out there, it's going to be found. and you can't screw up. And so there are things that are starting to bleed through right now. And mainstream, they are fighting it tooth and nail, or, you know, or they haven't been given the green light yet for whatever reason. And there's, you're going to have to talk about simulation theory eventually, because we are on the verge, what you're talking about here, which is, I think, a brilliant concept for your topic, which is we're on the verge of creating this now. We are really, really close. Mm-hmm. And there are movies, if you don't mind me touching on a few of them, there are movies that have talked about this now for the better part of 20 years. Also, I don't think it's a coincidence that we've done predictive programming in this for a while now, to where it's in the back of it's been in the back of my head for years. I've just been waiting for the tech to catch up. The first movie to really, really get to touch on it was based off a book. I think it was Omicron 3 from the 60s, which was turned into a movie in the 70s called World on a Wire, which was a German film. And World on a Wire, which is, I think it was 1975, if I'm not mistaken, touched on, it was basically, people think that the 13th Floor, that movie that came out a year before The Matrix, which came out, the 13th Floor came out in 98, same year as The Truman Show, go figure. And The Matrix came out in 99. But the 13th Floor was an absolute remake of World on a Wire, the German film. Which touches on, if anyone hasn't seen it, I know 1998 is a long time ago, but you check it out. If you get, don't watch World on a Wire, because it gets lost, because it's 70s and they couldn't do jack with special effects in 1975. But 1998, they did some wonderful, did you ever see 13th Floor?
Yeah, okay, yeah, right. Twice.
Perfect. So where it touched on that we were in, that we had, like now, present day, we figured out a way of creating a MMO that we could actually jack into, and it was completely immersive. And it was as good as the real thing. The resolution was, I've joked that the difference between our world and the video game world right now is just resolution. Mm. That's it. And a few senses, of course, which we haven't tapped into yet. Right now we've got sight and sound. We can generate a little bit of impulses as far as touch. We still don't have smell or sight, smell, touch, sound. Was it the sense?
Sense. Yep.
Touch, oh, taste. We haven't gotten taste yet. So when they were doing that in the 13th Floor, they were exploring that, and they realized that some of the NPCs, the non-player characters, were figuring this out, that they were in a virtual world. And then all of a sudden, you know, through a confusing plot line, which I won't get into right now, they figured out that when they logged out of the MMO, they figured out they were in an MMO.
Yeah.
And which is a great plot line. And that's why, and then of course The Matrix touched on that in 1999, but that is why I think it's going to come out whatever we are, because it's something I've stated for ever since I got into this, which is, I don't think we're going to be allowed to create what you're talking about, the 13th Floor scenario, because once you do, it creates a whole other layer of complexity. It changes reality. It distorts reality to where we lose perspective of where we are.
Yeah.
You get lost, and I don't think we're allowed. I don't think this place is built to where you can have a simulation inside a simulation inside a simulation. I don't think we're allowed to go that far. I think once you get close to that point, then things start getting revealed. It's like, okay, you know, you got it. You can't play God.
Yeah.
You know, here, you know, I think we've gotten about as close as we're going to get. Because you know, and also Dark City touched on that as well. The big thing there is, if all memory is just electrochemical, then how close are we to creating memories out of scratch? Let me real quick mention that there's been studies that have shown the reason why a lot of people get post-traumatic stress disorder. You know, like you've heard, like people from Vietnam, from the Vietnam War, hear helicopters, right? It's because the difference between electrochemically, between the actual event and the strong memory of the event is almost indistinguishable. It is so minute that so basically what it was something that they talked about in sports, and that was if you visualize things, it's like, oh, follow through, you know, you can visual, if you visualize it, it'll happen. And they did studies on this, and initially they thought it was just some weird memory thing where real quick, where they were talking about they did a study where people were shooting free throws, you know, in basketball. And it's like one group didn't shoot free throws. One group actually shot free throws every day. And the third group only thought about shooting free throws, just thought about it. Mm. And that third group still did better than the control group. And now they realize, well, they did better because the electrochemicals were simulating the real event. Yep. And so that's where we're getting really, really close to this.
And they say it's the same with lucid dreaming. I mean, I've read about studies where they get taught how to lucid dream, and then they learn a specific task or something within the dream only.
Yeah.
And their brain is actually compute that as real, and they pick it up in real life. It's amazing.
Yeah. 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 So I think we're almost there. It's really interesting to bring this up, because I saw recently the commercials about the new VR headsets,
yeah,
and how they're able to they're implementing the new TV technology, and it's getting really, really good to mm-hmm. where people are starting to, you know, freak out, and I mean, at that point, do you need amusement park rides anymore?
Exactly. Yeah.
There's an old 80s movie, if you get a chance, if you haven't seen it, it was with Christopher Walken, called Brainstorm.
Oh no, I have it actually. I have that downloaded.
Do you?
I haven't seen it yet. Yeah.
Oh, you got to check that out. The ending's kind of silly, but as far as what the subplot, but the initial, and I think it's based on another television show or movie, but it's about if you can record, that's what, you know, that whole thing is, if you put a different, you take a VR headset, and if it doesn't just have the ability to display, but an ability to record, if you can record somebody's thoughts, can you play them back to somebody else? Mm-hmm. And then it gets, you're talking about, at that point, amusement park ride's gone, because you can, anything, like you go hang gliding, you record it, you can give it to somebody, all of a sudden he's hang gliding. Same, they touched on it later, several years later, in a movie called, I think it was it Strange World? With Ralph Fiennes, I believe. I can't, where he was sell, it was illegal. You could record stuff, and you could sell black market versions of this.
Oh, I think I know what you're talking about. Actually, I've seen it. That
was it called Strange World? Someone in chat looked that up. It's with Ralph Fiennes. It was a 90s movie, where they were the same sort of thing. They were recording stuff, and he was like a drug dealer that would sell these memories for people that they could play in these little, I don't know, they were like little zip drive things. But anyway, it was really, really cool.
Existence?
No, that's not it. No, Ralph.
Ralph
Fiennes in the 90s. It was wasn't Strange World. It was, that's my show. That's but it's something along those lines. It's,
yeah, we can come back to that.
I can look it up. But anyway, it's a cool, but look, just look up Ralph Fiennes, you'll find it. It's got some really, really neat stuff in it.
Okay, so you agree that the line is starting to blur. So that takes me on to the next question. If this is a simulation, and that's a big if.
Yeah.
What does that mean? Where do we stand with God? I mean, if this is a simulation, then obviously someone created it.
Yeah.
But then there must be something outside of that, right? It's like the analogy where back in the day they used to say, well, the earth is flat, and then they would ask them, well, what is it standing on? And they would say, well, a turtle.
And yeah.
Say, well, what's the turtle standing on? They would say, well, four elephants, right? So it just keeps going and going. So when we, and I think for me, like religion is almost the same sort of thing. It's like, well, God created everything, but then, you know, who created God? And then you just keep going. So it's the same with the simulation theory. If it is a simulation, are we real? I mean, what happens when the game ends? Like, these sorts of questions pop up constantly for me. It's just like, it's so mind-boggling to think about, and it's very interesting. I mean, I spend most of my time just thinking about these things.
I agree with you. The mind-boggling is the word, because the human brain wants to compartmentalize.
Yeah.
We want to encapsulate whatever it is. We don't like, and I don't want to pick on Matt Boylan here, because I know he loves the infinite plane, we don't like thinking about infinity. It is something we toy with as children. You know, it's like, you just keep going, right? Just keep going, keep going. Mm. It's the whole counting sheep thing. It's like, you never get to the end, but the human brain can't deal with that. Yeah. It's like, eventually there's gotta be an end, right? There's gotta be an end. So when it comes to this world, I try not to freak people out too much. I try to say, look, live one world at a time if you can, because otherwise you're going to get into the Russian stacking doll argument, which is there's always a bigger doll that the other one fits into, and it just keeps, you know, getting bigger and bigger, and it never ends. Sooner or later, you're going to have to stop putting things into boxes. Not saying that you shouldn't think about that, but when it comes to this place, and we'll touch on the God concept. It is one of two things, and I've said this from week one. When it comes to this world, if it is an enclosed, encapsulated simulation, you know, like a holodeck. By the way, the holodeck used in Star Trek Next Generation, I think, was way more interesting than most because it was square. You know, it was a square box, because computers, people forget these little things. Computers don't like circles. Computers don't like curved shapes. They like squares. You know, they like, now you can put whatever you want inside that square, but eventually you're going to have to get to a box, because computers, you ask a computer to draw a circle, you're going, oh, it's easy. No, it's not easy for a computer to draw a circle. Eventually, when you zoom in, it's still just a bunch of steps, but it's so microscopic that you can't see it. A computer doesn't, you know, we can draw circles, although I'm wondering if you zoom in on our microscopic circles, what it looks like, but I don't want to get into that right now. So, when it comes to God and, you know, the simulation, one of two things. If this place was created, you know, obviously we'll get into that. If it was created, then there was a creator. Is the person that created this, is God a programmer? I have no doubt that God is a programmer. At the high, you know, people, because the only reason we didn't call him a developer or a programmer earlier is because programming wasn't a thing. Only now do we realize, when we build our stuff, I do believe that art imitates art and life imitates art and life imitates life, that we have to code stuff. You have to build in the machine language, and you have to develop it with the tools that are available to you. You can say, well, God has his tools, and they're divine and they're magical. I'm going, yeah, but there are probably some numbers involved. Even he has to deal with math and building stuff. So that being said, only one of two things is possible here. Either this place was built by a civilization greater than us, right? Or it was built by the divine. But then you're starting to split hairs, because how much greater does a civilization have to be better than us to be godlike?
Yeah.
Now, either way, you're going to still get to the same place. And that is, fine, if a greater civilization built this place, then at least it's one step closer to a divine power, you know, but who knows? I mean, there might be seven or eight tiers above them. You don't know. I've tried to, and I don't really tell a lot of people this, but I'll tell you, I mean, we've been doing this long enough that, you know, might as well get into some weird stuff here. I almost try nowadays, when I start thinking about this myself, is to not try to find God, not try to find the absolute divine, because I keep thinking that there's so many different layers in between that's not what it's about. It's about living, you know, it's about experiencing whatever world you're in, moving on to the next, whatever it is, and live, you know, living that plane, not trying to skip to the end of a book, you know, or an end of a series. It's like going through, like getting the entire Lord of the Rings set and then saying, well, where the heck to the end? I want to get all the way to the end. It's like, oh, say nobody buys the entire Lord of the Rings set. And then that's all. Oh, they throw the ring into the volcano.
That's a very good way of putting it. I like that analogy.
There was let me also throw one way. I'm not saying that God may be disappointing, but God may have just been the spark that started all the creativity. The spark itself may not have been that, you know, compared to all the creativity that's been happening, may not be that impressive compared, but you got to remember, before that, there was no spark. So I'll use the, there's an analogy I had. Okay. The American football. NFL. You can use any sporting thing. But I'll just use American football, or you know, we'll use soccer since it's worldwide, right? Mm-hmm. We'll use soccer. Your version of football. It is an amazing, elaborate system with so many things involved, right? Where, you know, you've got everybody from not just the players and the coaches and the people that are managing the stands and the people that selling the tickets and the people that built all the stands and the people that, you know, all the junior leagues and all the how many hundreds and thousands of millions of people that are involved in that sport. You know, you've got people out there that know the stats of the top 10 goalies in the world and the top 10, you know, shot makers in the world. You know, they can list you all the stats year by year of all these people. But when you go down to it, can you, and I know it's tougher with European football than American football. Can you tell me who created football? Where did it come from? Exactly. You know, where did that initial spark come from? Because it probably started out very modestly. I know it did in the United States with American football. It started out with a guy, I'm pretty sure his last name was Cannon. And all he did was create the rule book for it. He's going, you know what? This looks like a pretty good game. Here's the rule book for it. And then things just started branching off. And now it's a multi-billion dollar organization spanning all over the place. And it's really, really big. So when I've kind of appreciated, as I've gotten into the flat earth thing and the enclosed world, I've appreciated living the world as it is and not looking for the ultimate expression. Of course, everybody wants to know God. No question. But it's like, you know what? I don't think God wants to be found that easily. Yeah. Because I think it's like, I think for God, I'll use he just because I got to say something. I think God wants us to experience the splendor and the wonderful things that are about the different worlds. It's like, you know, don't necessarily look for him. You know, he's out there. He's always doing his thing. You know, look at all the other stuff that's been created because of him. But anyway, it's kind of like an actor. It's like, yeah, I know the actors, you know, they like shaking hands with people, but it doesn't mean anything if you haven't watched all the actors' movies.
Yeah, true. By the way, Martin says in the chat the film you were mentioning, Strange Days.
Strange Days, that's it. Strange Days. It was a weird title, Strange Days.
Yeah.
Yeah, with Ralph Fiennes. Great little movie. But still, if you're going to see Strange Days, watch Brainstorm. I believe it was 1983 when it was released. And it was strangely enough, Brainstorm was a weird movie because it was the last movie of Natalie Wood. She died during the shooting of that.
Oh, really?
She was a famous American actress who they were doing a break during shooting, and she went out on a yacht and they was found drowned, right? And they Robert Wagner, who was married to her, you know, they kind of, because they were both mainstream A-lister Hollywood people at the time, it was like, well, we'll just kind of not talk about it. Okay. Most people don't know there was a third person on that boat. You know who that third person was?
Who?
Christopher Walken. Nobody ever talks about that. And I thought, that's weird. He knew what happened. But, you know, they were, because they were co-stars in the movie, Christopher Walken.
Did she die after the movie was finished or before?
She died during the filming. And then they got her sister, who was really looked really close to her, to film some of the smaller parts, you know, some of the cleanup work. But it was interesting. Anyway, Brainstorm is still, I use a little test pattern of Brainstorm in some of the videos that I use. It's kind of a weird little twisty kind of old 80s graphics thing. But it's an interesting concept, which is if you can record I love concepts where your imagination goes with you. Yeah. Meaning if you can record human thoughts and play them back for other people, what applications could you use? And, you know, everything from entertainment to adult entertainment. But of course, like in this movie, the military got a hold of it. Military's going, oh man, it's unlimited what we can do with this from a military standpoint. You can train pilots without even having to put in the air. You can interrogate people just by putting them in a chair and hooking them up to something. You don't have, you know, there's all sorts of weird things you can do, but it's a fascinating concept. Oh, I'm sorry. And I won't give away the ending. But that where it gets into the reason why the movie kind of struck me so hard was that one of the scientists who was suffering from lung cancer, she dies during the movie, and she hooks up the set and records her death. And then it's like, okay, who's going to watch this thing? And what happens when you watch it? You know, what happened to her after she died? And that's was a fascinating undertone. Again, why wouldn't you? That's one of the things we would look at.
Yeah. Very interesting. Quick note, when we talk about simulation theory, what I was going to add is that we have computers, and when we think of simulation theory, we compare that to our own technology today, right? So, but that doesn't mean that if this is a simulation, it doesn't necessarily have to be a computer, does it? I mean, there could be other forms of technology that we can't even comprehend. So we are just comparing.
It doesn't have to be a computer, but I mean, it's got to be some sort of, it's got to be some sort of, there's no other word we there's really no word. Have for yeah, right now. The, I would use the some of the clues that I don't want to, I still believe we are in it is a physical world. Mm-hmm. I do believe that we are in a physical world, but, and I don't want to cheat too much by using the Morpheus argument, which is what is real. But when we break down, we've analyzed, it's like, look, you know, we know there's atoms, and we know that, you know, we are basically made up of energy. In the same way that in science fiction, holodeck images are just made up of energy. So is it a combination? Is where we are potentially a combination of something? Yeah. Is it a giant MMO combined with a holodeck, combined with a terrarium, combined with a planetarium, combined with all these other technologies, which we haven't merged into one yet, but somebody else figured it out. It's very possible that we're in, but the question is when, here's the big one, and you've already touched on this. What happens after?
Yeah.
Right. Is it the red dwarf scenario where all of a sudden we wake up and we were just plugged into something for like 10 minutes?
Yeah.
Were we just sitting at a bar playing across, you know, from somebody else?
Yeah.
You know, is it a recreational thing? Was it just was it a drug? Was it a television program? You don't know. Do I believe, by the way, that, and I've talked about this in other things, that everybody in this world is necessarily real, you know, is necessarily, all the other movies have touched on this, you know, are there NPCs in this world? And I'd say, yeah, you absolutely have to have NPCs in this world. All the great games now have huge forces of NPCs roaming around because nobody wants to be the person working in, no offense to anyone out there, working in the dry cleaners for 40 years. And all their, you know, with horrible lighting, you know, it's handing people shirts all the time. There's lots of NPC jobs. The reason, and you create them to, you know, to fill in the gaps.
Yeah.
And I do think there's a whole bunch of NPCs out there. And I'm not saying you should go out and try to look for them.
No.
But I do think there are.
I totally agree. I was actually going to touch on this because the way I see it, I think there's three levels. We have, level one, which is the NPCs that are very powerful. So you could say a lot of the people that maybe are in control, maybe they're NPCs. And then you have the other end, which is the extremely poor people who are like dying of hunger. Maybe just they're born and then they die for no reason. So maybe these two extremes are NPCs. And then something in the middle is us. And we're put here to try and sort of find the answers. I mean, regardless of what this is, whether it's a simulation or not, I think the one thing we could all agree on is that we've been put here to find out why we've been put here. We haven't been put here to work at a 9-to-5 every day and pay taxes. So I think we're being held down, and the ultimate goal is to figure out what's going on, right? So
I agree. The lady, the prophet from the Oracle from the Matrix said it best, where there's most people miss the line where it's in the second Matrix where they're in the park and he goes, it's a matter of choice. And he goes, And she goes, no, you've already made the choice. Mm. You're here to understand why you made the choice. It is something that I've kind of been dabbling with lately. And that is, if you were doing something like this, and you wouldn't leave a lot to chance, meaning, and I'm not going to say that we don't choose our own destiny. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that, and I don't know if you agree necessarily, but that we've already chosen our destiny way before we got here. And the path, kind of like the, again, another movie reference, the Adjustment Bureau.
Yeah.
Where the Adjustment Bureau is all about paths and how things, and you know, they're saying, oh, this path changed and this path changed. I'm going, yeah, but something like this, though, it's elaborate enough that you would choose your entire path ahead of time, because the last thing you'd want to do is spend a whole bunch of time here and have a crappy ending.
Yeah.
You know, you wouldn't want to waste that. I've also talked about with some people that it is kind of like a, because people say, well, you know, why are you here? Why are you here? You're here to learn things. I still think it's more of an educational thing. Mm-hmm. People, I thought of this a long time ago. It's like the world can really only be one of three things. It can be either entertainment, education, or confinement. It's got to be one of, or a blend of one of these three things. Well, if it's entertainment, a lot of people aren't having fun. There's a lot of people here, you know, this world is conflict. Let's call it what it is. If it's confinement, well, I mean, it's sort of confinement, but you know, there's no bars and, you know, it doesn't seem, you know, some people call it a prison planet, but it's not an obvious jail for anybody. Education, it does seem to be that at the very least you're learning a new perspective. And so I came up with something long time before I got into Flat Earth, and it's not Flat Earth related, but it is sort of like, you know, the meaning of could it be just something as simple as gaining perspective? Meaning, if this world, if what is outside of here is an unlimited dimension, or a dimension that's way more open-ended than what we have now, then it's sort of like the genie with the wishes scenario. And which is, we all know part of this, which is, okay, you rub the lamp, the genie comes out, he says, oh, you got three wishes, right? Mm-hmm. But since you're a clever person, you make one of those wishes. Come on. More wishes.
Yeah.
More wishes. It's a kid's joke thing. Kid goes, I wish for 1,000 more wishes or 10 more, whatever you can think of, right? So it's like, okay, you wish for a whole, you know, because there's no rules for a genie, right? 1,000 more wishes. Well, you start wishing for all sorts of stuff. I mean, you know, everyone's got all the, you know, their list, you know, money and power and sex and fame and whatever it is. And you can do this for a long time. The thing is, in an unlimited dimension, there's no time limit. That's the key here. The big thing is time. I think that Einstein, regardless whether people think that Einstein was completely legit or not, he was very quotable. And he had some quotes that were amazing. I mean, not the greeting card ones like, you know, gravity isn't responsible for people falling in love. That's really cute. But the ones where he said, imagination is more important than knowledge. And I didn't get that for the longest time because I was going, why would a physicist be saying this? That doesn't make any sense to me. And then I started thinking about relative time and an infinite universe. I was going, wow, that is the only thing. Because imagination is your only weapon against infinity. It's the only thing you've got, because eventually you're going to get bored. And see where I'm going here. And that is, sooner or later, you're going to have all the boats and the cars, and you're going to be famous, and you're going to be a leader, and you're going to be all this other stuff. Sooner or later, you're going to get bored with this. And you're going to go to the genie, and you're going to go, look, man, I'm out of ideas. What can I do here? I've still got a ton more wishes to use. He goes, well, you could go here. And it's like, what's that? And it's like, well, it's a completely restricted universe. You have limited lifespan. It's almost full of inevitable conflict. You could get sick. You've got mortality and you know, all sorts of, pain is an everyday thing. And you just, that sounds horrible. It's like, yeah, but when you're done, you'll appreciate this one like you'd never believed. But you got to go there. And then, you know, then you ask the genie, you go, what's the catch? And he goes, well, the catch is you can't remember that we even talked about this. And that's the thing. You can't, it's the whole, is it a metaphor or analogy? Metaphor. You can't have your cake and eat it too. That's not how it should go. It's, you can't have your cake eat the cake and still have your cake. Yeah. You can't come to a world like this, remember the unlimited universe, and still live your world. It's like a trust fund for someone. Which is why when you have a trust fund for a kid, one of the things they tell parents is like, don't tell the kid they're getting a trust fund. Mm-hmm. If a kid is going to get a trust fund of $10 million at age 20, you don't tell them they're going to do that because their motivation just flags. They don't do jack.
Yeah.
So anyway, sorry, I'm rambling, but you see where I'm going here is this world seems to me to be gaining perspective for what we had. You don't appreciate an unlimited universe until you come here. The Joe Walsh song, the ex-Eagles singer, where a song called Life's Been Good, where he was basically talking about the life of a rock star. Everyone knows this song, my Maserati does 185, I lost my license, now I don't drive, blah, blah, blah. He's going about all he's basically describing, he goes, look, the life of a rock star should be bliss on tap, and it's not. There's always something to complain about. And that's what he was saying. He's basically saying in this song that it doesn't matter how rich, how powerful, how beautiful, how famous you are, you always have something to complain about. Mm. And I thought that was fascinating that you would, that's it's true with anybody. It doesn't matter. John Paul Getty, the famous American industrialist, had a 110 room mansion, right? Money beyond, could never spend it ever in a million years. And yet he was bothered to no end that his guests were using his phones to make long distance phone calls. So he rips out all the phones and installs payphones in the hallways because it bugged him so much. Shouldn't have bugged him. Most people would be like, who cares? Who cares? It's just money. But everyone has something to complain about. So, sorry, boiling this down.
I totally agree.
That's what I think this world is. I think it is a perspective to reinvent yourself and appreciate what you had.
Exactly. And I think a lot of what we had has been taken away from us. And I think we're just beginning to start noticing it. And someone in chat, I think it was Cindy, said something about a labyrinth full of clues. And if you are awake, you figure it out, you find the clues. If you're not, you get distracted and you don't. So I think with the flat earth, it's the same sort of thing. It's one of those clues that we've been missing this whole time. And it was taken away from us, and we're just
there's no accident here that it came out. There's no reason I should not be talking about flat earth. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to be doing flat earth. This is the last thing. 2 years ago, you would have told me I was doing flat earth, I would have laughed you out of the room. Would have said, that is the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. And it's the great t-shirt. And that is, I got into flat earth because I tried to shut it down. Mm-hmm. But is flat earth a clue for, part of the revealing of this world? I really do. At the very least, it opens the mind up to, and I know it makes it sound like a religion, but it does. It opens the mind up to everything else. I don't judge people anymore. Mm. I can't. I love it when people email me or call me and they say, oh yeah, I'm gonna tell you something, but I think it's really nuts. You're gonna think I'm crazy. I'm going, dude, do you even know what I do every day? I go, the videos I'm putting out basically say that, I'm believing in something that society for hundreds of years thought was absolutely insane. And now I don't. So people that they look into this, the best part for me for watching people, go through the whole flat earth process is that they're open to completely new concepts that they would have never entertained before. The tree thing that came out, late last year, so that tree thing would have never gained traction 3 years ago. But flat earth certainly, it's like, holy smokes, that tree thing, now people are looking like, what else is there? What else is there? Everyone's revisiting every other, I hate using the word because it's overused now, conspiracy. People revisit all their old conspiracies now and they say, oh yeah, I've looked at this and this, and I'm looking at it completely differently now. And I know some of the heavy, heavy conspiracy guys say, well, diminishes all the conspiracies that matter. I'm just going, look, they all matter. I'm going, all this does is it gives you a different way of looking at it. Mm-hmm. It's been, but yeah, I do think it's a clue. It's part of something. It's part of something bigger, and I still think that the authority is trying to turn it into something else.
Yeah, I mean, your video a few days ago, I think it was the day before yesterday, about the videos that went missing on YouTube.
Oh, right. Holy smokes. That was, and I got to thank DITRH for Dave for making me do that video. Cause I mentioned it. I was on Skype and I was looking, cause I look at the stats every freaking day, you know, multiple times a day. I was going, and I've been watching, I was waiting for it to happen. Cause it's been fluctuating. It goes 7-4, 7-4, 7-4. Then all of a sudden 4, and I was going, okay. And I go, Dave, you know, they went hard 4. He goes, you got to make a video on that. I go, okay. So I did. And then, you know, I was glad I did, because the second I did, within 10 minutes, Globebusters contacted me, Bob. Mm-hmm. And he goes, you know, it's interesting because I sort my videos by upload date. And he goes, upload date shows the real numbers. You know, he goes, upload date showing 15. I was going, that's really great. I go, why do you sort by upload date? He goes, oh, because it shows me exactly within the minute when the most recent videos come in. So if a video was, you know, it was uploaded 3 minutes ago, that's what's at the top of the list. And you're constantly seeing this new stream of videos. And yeah, it's weird because they at the powers that be, otherwise known as the authority, they're kind of paradoxical, where they've allowed the whole flat earth concept to be recommended to people. One, mm-hmm. you know, recommended in their sidebar, recommended for you, even though you're looking at JFK, flat earth. It's like, why is that over there? Two, they allow it in autoplay. So if you just leave your machine running and you're watching videos on something, all of a sudden a flat earth video will come on for no apparent reason. You'll be on the other side of the room going, what am I listening to? I've had people contact, but at the same time, it's like they're, I don't want to steal a show name, they're curbing our enthusiasm in some ways. Because I've been watching the count and I was going, once it got to about 7, it kept hovering around 7, and I'm seeing all the new people and all these new videos. I'm going, how is it? And it drops to 6 and back up to 7. I'm going, how is this thing not keep going up? Turns out it was always going up, and no one noticed, because the people believe what is shown to them. And so it's like, well, YouTube says it's 7 million, therefore it's 7 million. But because programmers don't want to pick on them too much, because I've coded a little bit myself, programmers are lazy. They forget things. So programmers, you know, there's got to be 20 different filters in YouTube. Yeah. Somebody forgot the frickin' upload date. And so, and even though now when I like the last day, and I mentioned to, I sent a message to Bob, I watched it go from 15 to 2.
Really? Well, on the
bouncing back and forth. And that's why I made the video. I said, I go, sooner or later, they're going to fix this. So I took screenshots. I go, look, it's at 15, which makes sense, because all the other topics that we were going along the lines with, we were keeping up with them. Mm-hmm. But so it's weird. I don't.
They're just changing the numbers.
I mean, how are they changing the numbers, why?
Are they just changing numbers, or
that's all they're doing? It's not, they're not killing videos for people that I'm not saying, and I clarified this in the video. They're not killing the videos. They're killing the relevant numbers, search results. So, because people immediately went on, you know, their channels. It's like, dude, all my videos are still here. It's like, yeah, your videos are still there, but when you search for it, the algorithms are being capped. Mm-hmm. So they're capping the relevant results. So if you go in right now, I think it's still capped at 4, and that shouldn't be 4. It was 4 back in the end of 2015. Mm-hmm. That's not the point. It went from 7 to 4. I don't know why they're trying to. I think they're trying to keep the flames from really heating up, because the numbers can only get so high. Here's just thought of this. The numbers can only get so high before somebody with money, namely a producer. When trends get certain to a certain point, people with money want to capitalize on that. And producers have already been looking at it when it was at 7 and saying, hey, you know, because they look at mainstream topics and they say, okay, if there are shows based on this and this and this, and Flat Earth is beating all those, hell, it's a no-brainer. We just go with Flat Earth and we turn it into something mainstream. If you start restricting the numbers, it gets those people a little nervous. They're like, oh, I don't know. I don't know if it's really there. But it turns out the numbers were all, I should have known. But again, it's good that some people saw it. So I, you know, the real numbers are 15. And Bob told me they were as high as 17 just recently. So, which is way up there. I mean, considering the topic has gotten almost no, we've done that with almost no marketing budget at all. And on top of that, the part which I love throwing at people, you already know this, is that every search engine in the world right now, if you type in the earth is, or earth is, or even in some cases is the, all you have to do is type is the, in some cases, it'll say earth flat. It'll fill in earth flat no matter what. And that's because people that are into it are constantly searching on it. Yeah. And it's like,
they can't hide it forever. I mean,
the what?
I said they can't hide it forever.
No,
it's getting too big.
It's too big, and it's too
real,
too polarizing. And to date, as you know, and people will say, well, you're using the wrong term. I don't think so. We still have a 99% retention rate, meaning nobody that goes into this, and I only say 99 because I'm still waiting for somebody that'll come out against it that was in it. Mm-hmm. Well, there was one guy, you know who he was, Tiger Dan, who was in it, and then all of a sudden said, I'm not in it, everybody's a fraud, I hate everybody, and then he disappears.
Yeah.
Nobody else has come out against this. You can't make that claim with even, a religion in some cases. I'll just pick on Scientology. Yeah. Scientology, right? People join Scientology, they hate it, they leave it, they write books about how much they hate it. I mean, I don't know what the percentage is, got to be at least 10% or something like that.
Yeah.
Nothing has I don't care what model you follow, whether it's the infinite plane or the dome or whatever, lands beyond the poles. Don't care what model you follow. Nobody that goes down this road comes back and says, yeah, you know what? I'm going back to the globe. Globe's still a great model. They put the globes back up on the shelves. Nobody does that. And you've got to wonder why. Yeah. And of course the part which I love more than anything, which is the amount of women that are, you know, because conspiracy is still a heavily male dominated thing, and women are way more suspicious, you know, women, female instincts, that whole thing.
And they're us.
Women get into this thing. It's like, yeah, I do believe that they jump on this and they go, they can smell BS, and they're going, you know what? This totally seems, you know, it's resonating. And I use them as a barometer. I look at them and go, if they're jumping on this as fast as I think they are, then, you know, I have no sense to doubt it. I still don't. Nobody that I've even interviewed, the people that have come on to my show, all the subject matter experts, you know, the testimony shows, none of them have recanted. Nobody's even come out against them. And you'd think, especially with the military guys, it's because it's easier to come out against it. You'd think, again, at least an army guy or a navy guy, it's like, you know, another ship guy comes out, you know what, your missile guy was completely full of crap. Here's what. Nobody, no emails, no phone calls. Nobody challenges these guys.
Yeah, so, I agree. And that's what I was thinking about this today when I was watching the Trump inauguration.
I watched that this morning too.
Did you watch it? His speech was, I'll admit, it was a nice speech. It was nice to listen to, even though I know it's not, it's all fake. But I was thinking, what if this whole Trump thing is a way for them to get all of these people who are seeking truth to think, okay, now we've got someone who's going to help us unravel 9/11, this and that, so that they take away the heat from the flat earth, so that everyone's concentrating on that as opposed to this. Because they need something so big, because flat earth is very big, so they need something bigger to squash it down, right?
But, well, maybe not even squash it down. You know me, I try to go with a glass half full. Maybe they chose him because it blurs the lines between hardcore political, what they put off as reality, and media creations. I still think it's fascinating and a bit hypocritical that the media industry that created him, you know, made him a reality television star, now hates him because he's a president. It's like, oh, no, you can have a show forever. And, you know, we'll do t-shirts and do promos for you and people will do guest spots on your show. Oh, president? No. Now we've all turned against you and no one will perform at your inauguration. It's like, well, why? It's like you didn't mind when he was saying all that crap on his show. Now he's doing it, you know, in an office and now you're going against him. I do think it could help us in the end though, because I don't want to say things too derogatory because I've never voted in my life, but it is so out there that we in the States voted in a reality television star as president of the United States. You got to remember, we've already had actors, you know, Arnold Schwarzenegger was the governor of California. Jesse the Body Ventura was the governor of Minnesota. You know, we've done this before. But we've never taken it. And even let's this way, we even were thinking of changing the rules to make Arnold president because he wasn't born here. So we were thinking of changing that to allow him. And that, and actually people would have gone along with that because they want to blur the lines between entertainment and what they push off as reality. The Obama thing, a lot of people still don't remember. The actor's name is not going to mean anything to you. The actor the black actor that played the general in the latest Superman movie, not the Superman Batman movie, but the Superman movie, he was quoted on the radio. They gave somebody mentions something about Obama and he goes off and says, look, I was the guy that coached Obama and taught. He goes, he's modeled after me. And people are like, holy. So then, so they did follow-ups. And of course, you know, he shut up after that. He wasn't going to do a whole Joan Rivers thing, but having Donald Trump as the president really blurs reality, doesn't it? Because it's like he's a caricature of himself now anyway. He's not the Donald Trump of the 80s and 90s. This is a completely different guy. I can't believe that no one even like went off his age. He's the oldest president to ever be elected, right? No one ever talked about that really. You know, they did when like Bob Dole was going to be president, but Donald Trump, it's all about, you know, what he says. He's pandering to the that whole thing where he went after the press conference when he called CNN fake news. Yeah. During that press conference, it's like what are you doing? Yeah. You know, what is this stuff that he's doing? Maybe having him as president, not necessarily a good idea for anything else, but for the whole flat earth community, maybe not that bad, because people, it also opens your mind. It's like, look, yeah, you've got a television star, not even a good one, as the president of the United States. What else is possible? So yeah, it may take a little heat, you know, it may take some of the intensity off of us, but remember, we've already got some stories, whether they're real or not, that we're already tied to him in flat earth.
Yeah.
So we'll see, you know, I'm waiting for a speech where he brings it up. His advisor has already done it with climate change. He hasn't done it yet though. You know, he said, what, you know, because they're trying to equate again. If you didn't want to put the vocabulary into the system, you don't use it. They've been really, really careful over the last year of introducing flat earth and replacement of the word crazy or insane or far, whatever wing, mm-hmm. you know, really outlandish claims. And I think that they're doing it deliberately. Partly, I think it's because of a revelation. Because I'm thinking, like you said, you can't hide it forever. So if you can't hide it forever, maybe they have a way of turning it in, you know, turning it into something else, or maybe controlling how it's released. I don't know. I still think, you know, the only way they're going to do it was with some sort of other civilization.
Yeah, I think that's why the simulation theory as well. I think that could sort of play a part. I don't know what you if you've looked into the Mandela effect or what you think of it, but I mean, there's so many things happening that it's just, there's so many options. I think that's also another objective that they have, is to flood us with so much that we get so confused that we don't know what's real and what's fake anymore, and so we can't decide, so we're just in limbo basically. But I mean, a lot of flat earthers, most of us know the earth is flat, and ultimately that's one of the most important things, because once you expose that, then everything else just crumbles, doesn't it?
Yeah, the there was a listener that had contacted me last year, and he was saying, he goes, whether you like it or not, he said the Mandela effect is tied to flat Earth in some ways. Mm-hmm. And he goes more than you might think. I go, how so? And he goes, because they're two very, very big things that seem to question reality as we know it. And I go, yeah, I go, and I, don't get me wrong, I believe in the Mandela effect. I do. I really do. Because in simulations, I've seen sort of stuff like this, and I kind of explain it like those weird things. If you've owned computers long enough, if you've used the same document and saved over it and saved over it and saved over it enough times, you start seeing weird things happen. Meaning you open up the document and all of a sudden you'll see something there that shouldn't be there from a time before, you know, basically, and you can't explain it. You know, there's still things that happen in computers. We have no idea. You could ask the developer who wrote the code going, boy, I have no freaking idea. It's a combination between the processing and the operating system and the proprietary software. Mm-hmm. There's a mix of sometimes that happens that you'd get these ghosting things. But the reason why Mandela effect is never going to be as big, and I'm not doing rah-rah flat earth here, I'm saying it's not going to be as big as flat earth, is because we don't have the ability to record thought mm-hmm. right now. Because Mandela effect is like, yeah, I remember the Berenstain Bears.
Yeah. Right?
How can I prove that to somebody? You know, it's like, you can't. There's nothing you can do. I mean, we have problems with the stupid black and white dress. You know, that's in real time. That's sitting on your screen. You got one person say it's black, the other person say it's white. Both are right, mm-hmm. but you don't, you know, and if you have multiple people in the room, who's right there? So, but the Mandela effect is also, I think it also helps, because then people start questioning, all right, what do I think I know? And am I different? Am I remembering things differently from other people, and why? So I think it all kind of helps. It's kind of a mishmash of stuff.
You think this year is 2017 is the year for big exposure?
Ah, man, it'd be nice. I'm a huge media fan. Mm. So I've seen and read and absorbed a lot of plot lines over my life so far. I'm not that old, but I mean, I've absorbed a lot of media, and the plot line is overdue for whatever this is. If you believe, if you guys know anything about how, you know, act one, act two, act three, that sort of thing, it feels, and it's felt like this for a while now. And I know that things move slower in the world of geopolitics and the grand scheme of things. Mm-hmm. It feels like we ended act two a while ago, and we're in this weird little intermission lull before act three. Yeah. Act three is always the big show, the big finale. Everybody knows what act three is. And I've been waiting for it for some time. And I'm trying, there's a trigger that hasn't been tripped yet. And I don't know what that is. I still believe it's the 100th monkey effect, where, you know, you have to have a certain number of people. There's got to be a certain saturation before it turns. Unfortunately, with us,
is in the chat, and he says it's to do with Antarctica, and something's probably going to happen there.
That'd be a nice way to do it. Sure, why not? Eventually, you're gonna have to make the leap. Here's where it gets weird. Eventually, I don't want to reference any movies. You guys can take your pick on this one. Eventually, you're gonna have to make the leap. If you're the authority and you're gonna create this plot line, if you're gonna take it to Act Three, you're gonna have to make the jump to something that's out there. Mm-hmm. You know, all of a sudden, you're gonna have to enter the world of movies where you wake up one morning and there's something on the news that just stops everybody dead in their tracks.
Yeah.
They're like, whoa, what in the world is this? Everything that I have seen so far, and for a while I thought it was because they were waiting for something in particular. Now I think it's more that they were waiting for the social media infrastructure to be finished. Mm-hmm. It wasn't, we all know that, I mean, heck, I was one of the first ones to say, look, the Act Three will be televised. But now I realize that television wasn't enough. Then the internet came out. Then it was high-speed internet. Then it was everyone had a cell phone. Then the smartphones came out. Then social media was attached to the cell phones. It's about as concrete as it gets now. There's everything is so integrated that if something, if a big event happens, and I don't care where it is, it's as long as it's an industrialized nation somewhere, everybody in every country should know about it in under 30 minutes. Mm-hmm. And by that, I mean, and the only reason I say even 30 minutes is because it takes, you know, some people are doing something. They actually don't have their phone in front of them, but everyone will fire, you know, fire their Facebooks up. Facebook will crash for a while. You know, Twitter will crash for a while, whatever it is. And the internet, you know, but there's so many different outlets that not everything will crash. So that's the best part. Beforehand, the internet would literally, if you had a major event, a major revelation, that even was 10 years ago, the internet would just shut down. It wouldn't be able to handle the load. Now everything's spread out enough that, yeah, there'll be certain things that'll crash. But some things will still be up. And then, you know, once they absorb and get things back up. So yeah, that's what I think 2017, man, if it isn't, I don't know what they're waiting for. Everything's ready to go. Yeah. There's nothing left I can think of technology wise that isn't in place. You don't need anything. As far as I know, there aren't any quantum leaps that we're supposed to be making tech wise. Nobody's waiting for the new, the iPhones are gone as far as they're going to go. You know, iPads, the wristwatches. The
technology that they have is that they show us is probably. What they have is a lot more advanced anyway than
sure. The military, of course, is gonna have the best stuff. But the social, again, the fraction that the general population has is so good now. It is the double-edged sword, if you believe it. It's why they're having such a hard time faking anything. You know, when they're doing false flags, they can't even show you the event even close anymore. Take your pick. I mean, forget about the stuff that's to come, like the Mars mission that can never happen.
Yeah.
The moon, there's supposedly somebody let me know there's like a new moon competition to send probes to the moon. Yeah. Pff, that's not going to happen.
And the SpaceX, the rocket landings.
Oh, that SpaceX so rocket horrible. Landing back on the pad. What the hell was that? the fear beat every so often. They were doing it in the States for a while, but now they're just doing it overseas.
Yeah,
you know, because they realized like they couldn't even that nightclub in Florida, you know, where 99 people or 100 people died.
Yeah,
it's like that fell apart so quickly that it's like, okay, we'll do something in Paris, we'll do something in Germany, we'll do something here, you know, just to get, you know, it's the Americans, because the Americans are still really hyped up. The conspiracy crowd there is, you know, they overanalyze everything now.
Yeah. So. And everyone sort of follows what the Americans do anyway. I mean, most of the world, most of the information comes from your side. So
So, but we still can't fake anything now. We had our last shots, and now I think they've pretty much given up on the small stuff, because the what we're getting at was the technology that the general population has access to is good enough that you can detect anything. Which is why I said last year that if somebody gave me an unlimited budget and asked me to fake the Mars program, I'd tell them it can't be done. You cannot fake any sort of space program right now, because the population will be able to look at it, compare notes in real time, and all it takes is one person finding a couple frames out of sequence, and they'll say, yeah, there it is. And then, you know, it shares to everybody. You can't stop it. The days of curbing, if once it gets out, that line that Anne Hathaway said in one of the Batman, she goes, everything sticks. You know, once it's out there, it's out there. You're not going to be able to get rid of it. You know, yeah, you can copyright it to death, but
yeah.
Anyhow.
So, yeah. So, what have you got? Anything else coming up?
Oh boy. In 2017, I mean, right now I'm just doing my thing. Strange World, which I'm doing. I just finished episode 88, which is amazing considering it's a weekly show. Getting so many emails. I'm doing a Q&A emails show now. Still doing the shows with Patricia. She's going to fire those up again pretty soon.
Okay.
There's
your radio show. What day is it? Tuesdays?
Oh yeah. Tuesday nights. at 7 Pacific, 10 Eastern. That's on Truth Frequency Radio. And, you know, just the other work, working on other things with other people that haven't materialized yet, but it's only a matter of time. I try to tell people in the Flat Earth community, don't get, I know it, you know, people get burned out and they come back. Don't get frustrated, because we're at the stage now where, and I hate to say this because it sounds too greed. I'm not going to use personal greed here, but this thing will get to the next level because there'll be some non-flat earthers out there that will see it as a chance to, you know, they're not going to say, oh, we're going to spread the word of flat earth. They see flat earth as a way of monetary gain, and they're going to do it. And I'm saying, look, it's going to be, it's just a question of who's going to pull the trigger, who's going to be the first person to go on the dance floor and do this. And I still think the mainstream media is being curbed in that regard. I don't think that they're being allowed to touch on this. I mean, but again, remember, it was only a year ago that Neil deGrasse Tyson and B.O.B. were doing their thing. So it only take one person. I don't know who it's going to be, but I know it's going to happen.
Yeah, I do. Me too. I mean, it's very exciting. The wait, the anticipation is building up. I agree with you that you can almost feel it. There's something coming. It's not even about.
Yeah.
It's something in the
I have never gotten discouraged through this thing, mostly because when I started doing it, it was complete, and it still is for me, it's been completely unsolicited. That's how it's always been, right? It's like, look, the chain of events that has led up to now, that nothing has hampered me. Nobody, you know, I've never been threatened, never been, you know, bribed. No, I've never gotten any weird emails or phone calls. And it's felt so organic that all, you know, all the people that are building up, and of course all the positive energy. Forget about the comments. Let me end with this. Forget the comments in YouTube are going to be out there. A wise but very young woman said, "Haters going to hate." And that's very true. There's people, trolls are going to troll no matter what. It doesn't matter if it's flat earth. They're going to troll something else if it's not flat earth. You got to just brush them off. I tell people, don't look at it. I didn't even turn on the comments for any of my videos for the first 6 months because I didn't even want to deal with it. And after I turned them on, I generally don't look. The emails that have come in have been, which is why I put my email address, my phone number out there. Emails have come in 99% positive. The phone calls, 99% positive. Everyone that I see in the community is mostly 99% positive. And the only reason, I swear this is the last point, is the only reason there's dissension in the ranks is because we don't have an opponent to fight. We don't have, there's nobody out there in the science community that's willing to sacrifice it and come at us. The closest we've had to date, I mean, Neil deGrasse Tyson, did a great showing and all that, but he didn't take questions. He didn't debate anybody. He just said, oh yeah, this is gravity. Drop the mic. Joe Rogan, for a guy that said, you know, I'm never going to do a flat earth show, brought it up on 12 different shows, dedicated an entire hour against Eric Dubé, which is pretty impressive. And then the latest, John B. Wells, who I think partly he's doing it. I'm going to call him out and say it. I hope maybe he'll hear it, maybe he won't. Look, he's not dumb. He knows the ratings on Flat Earth. Yeah. He knows how mad Flat Earthers. He might as well have just walked up to a hornet's nest and just started whacking on it with a stick, because that's what anyone that goes after Flat Earth, that's what they're going to get. And he knew this. And he's like, why not? You know, I'm in the twilight of my career anyway. So, but we don't ignore the bad stuff that's happening in flat earth as far as the dissension in the ranks. Yeah. It is no different than a standing army, like the old Roman army. Yeah. They're just bored. You know, the Roman army's got no one to attack. So it's like, all right, let's just start sparring with each other. And people are rooting for different sides. It's not like anyone hates each other, honestly. It's because that'll all change once we have there's a unified front against us, then all the crap we have between us, that'll go away, and we can just pound on anybody that dares oppose us.
Totally agree. And on that note, we've been broadcasting for about an hour and a half. That was an amazing show, Mark. That was a very good. Eight people watching, Dave and Patricia on the show. Actually, Dave was just saying that Patricia has been spamming the Trump chat today where he was giving a speech about
Earth.
So I think that's a very good way of doing it. I mean, whenever I watch a video, regardless of what it's about, even if it's about cooking some recipe, I'll go in the comments and I'll type Earth is flat, look it up, just that.
And you're right, going into just about any forum, the ones that have been taking it on the chops lately, from what I understand, is Russia Today, you know, RT, because they throw out a lot of space stuff. And we haven't even been asking people to do that, but you find any space story with open forums.
Yeah.
Oh my God, the flat earthers just go in there and just light it up. And and it's great because people still, you know, it's the way of exposing people. Yeah. And I love the challenge out there. I smile every time I see a major YouTube channel come out, you know, with a whole bunch of followers. And it's like, I'm going to knock out this flat earth crap. It's like, man, you and 200 other channels before you have tried. And all you're doing is you're exposing people. You're just converting. You're just converting for us, which is fantastic. You know, you're shooting, you think you're doing something. All you're doing is shooting wooden arrows into a bonfire.
Yep.
That's all you're doing.
I totally agree. So amazing, Mark. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, happy to
do it. Really enjoyed it. It was so much fun.
Yeah. Yeah. Tons of fun.
Just a quick note. Do you remember a game called Ultima Online back in the day?
It was I do remember Ultima Online. I didn't. You were a big Ultima guy?
I was a big Ultima guy. Yeah. I never got into World of Warcraft. I was Ultima. I still have my boxed PC disc. But yeah, I used to.
Nice. Nice. Yeah. I was a huge. I played a lot of games. I still have, let me throw this out there real quick. I've still got, everyone's got their guilty pleasure games, and some of my guilty pleasure games are super dumb, but I love MMOs and I love hardcore stuff and I love first person shooters, but there's only so much you can play. But sometimes I like playing just the simple crap, like look up anything that PopCap has made.
PopCap.
You know, PopCap games, it's gonna make me say you're no gamer, but like Plants vs. Zombies.
Oh, I love that game.
Plants vs. It's like such a simple game, but I came into that late. Yeah. I found because Warcraft did kind of a version of it inside their game, and people said, "Oh yeah, it's Plants vs. Zombies." I'm going, what's that? And then I started playing. I was going, "Oh, totally addicted to that." Yeah, and brilliant. Everyone's got their guilty pleasure games, and. Still my all-time favorite, I think way back, I won't play it now, but my all-time favorite from the old days was Pac-Man. I was because I bought a book that had the pattern, you know, because it was simple algorithms. It wasn't random algorithms, and I played it and won some tournaments. It was fun. So
brilliant. All right, Mark. It's been a great show. Everyone's been enjoying it. We didn't have many trolls
good.
Maybe we'll do it again someday.
Yeah.
I know you're busy, but in the future, we get together and maybe talk about more flat earth.
All right, man.
Well, thanks everyone for being here. And I'll be back with episode 3 soon. I actually have a very interesting guest lined up. I'm not going to tell you now. I think I told you, Mark, didn't I? I think I told you in the email.
You did.
Yeah.
You
did. I won't disclose it now, but I have someone coming on that's, I've been a follower for quite a long time, actually. So we'll see how that goes. And I will see you all next time. Bye.